Premier, can we have a quick time? Standing on the stairs.
Okay.
March in a band and.
No.
Happy. Thank you.
Good morning, members. Please can I request all members that are participating in the event to deactivate their cameras for this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Masithandaze. Almighty God, where you have called us to govern this province, we ask your help to make decisions and laws that will be just and will promote the interests of the people. On machtige God, on speed, that ige drende ons vergaderings. Ons dienodege wijsheid sal gee, en ons motive saver sal ho. Dat I ons sal help om ons te kortkomenge te oorkom en al ons beslote aan I op te dra. Sigelela nkosi ilizwe lethu nabantu balo. Umisele nkosi ukulunga kwiphondo lethu. Nkosi sigelela iAfrika. Gcina abantwana bayo. Kokela nkosi inkokheli zayo. Inike uxolo nkosi iAfrika. All this we beg in your most holy name. Amen. You may all be seated. Thank you very much. Welcome. On this special day, in a historic town, and I just want to do the following. And I appreciate our host, and that is the Moravian Church, under the leadership of Mary Hector of the Moravian Church. Will you please put our hands together? And of course, we appreciate the presence of Reverend Edson, Chair of the Museum, the Genadendal Museum, which we are going to do the tour later. Let us please put our hands together. Honorable Premier, we are hosted here, of course, by the Overbeck District Municipality. And it is my honor to appreciate and acknowledge the district mayor, His Worship, Mr. Saki Frank, and there he is. Thank you. The mayor and the speaker of Tiabades Kloof Municipality, we appreciate and acknowledge them in absentia, and all the dignitaries, the mayors, the speakers that are here. But I just want to do the following. During my term as speaker, I made a commitment that in 2019, that we are going to take SOPA and the opening of Parliament, Honorable Premier, to every corner of the province. And thank you, Honorable Premier, and the Honorable Members for making that possible in supporting this very historic moment to do this, not only in the city, but to do it in the corners of this province, in the far-flung areas where ordinarily people would not see a member of parliament, but they see the whole parliament here. Thank you very much for that. I think it's important that we acknowledge the village of Genadendal is the oldest Moravian mission village in South Africa, with the church buildings and the school that dates back to 1738. And that is a milestone. The former president and the South African Democratic Father and the founding president of a democratic dispensation, Utata Nelson Mandela, he renamed the official residence of the presidents in Cape Town from Westbrook to Genadendal. And he was doing this in honor of this village. That's the very important piece about the history of where we are. It is hoped that through our hosting this year's event here, Honorable Premier, Honorable Members, more people will be exposed to this town. We hope, with its vernacular architecture, musical traditions, language, and its long tradition of humanitarian efforts and political struggle, a history that can continue to inspire us now and for the future. Honorable members, members of the executive, the deputy speaker, distinguished guests, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to present to you our esteemed guest and the man of the moment, our first citizen, His Excellency, the Premier, Mr. Allan Wynd.
Honorable
Honourable Premier, honourable members, in line with COVID-19 regulations, singing at public gatherings is prohibited. But we have made provision for the national anthem to be played so that we are able to acknowledge and recognize the traditions of our country. Now they play the national anthem will be played. Let us observe, let us please rise. Thank you. You may all be seated. The time, you may please deliver the State of the Province address.
Thank you very much, Honourable Speaker. Speaker, members of the Cabinet, Leader of the Opposition, members of this Legislature, to the DG, to the district mayor and mayors here present, to the speakers and councillors, to the elders of this great town, Genadendal. It is a great privilege and honor to be here today, to address you. Not only you and the citizens of Genadendal, but the citizens of this province. This is not like it was a year ago. This is a new normal. And even this parliament is a new normal, where only a few of us are gathered in this away from the legislature. And Speaker, thank you very much for that. But a few of us are gathered in the room here today. But again, there are colleagues sitting in the seat of parliament, the legislature, back in the city of Cape Town, but also there are members of this parliament who are in their constituencies. We are spread far and wide across this province as I have the privilege and honor to deliver this State of the Province address in what is this new normal, a very difficult time actually for our province, our country, and for the world. Speaker, in line with that new normal, I am also going to do something a little bit different today. My speech is here, and it has been cut and trimmed, and if I had to stand here and read this speech to you, we would probably be here for 2 hours, and I'm sure that you wouldn't want to have a politician reading to you wherever you are across the province, or sitting here in the House today reading a speech for 2 hours. So in this new normal and in this modern world, Speaker, I'm going to table this speech. I'm going to table the speech, and the speech has just as I'm speaking now been WhatsApped to every member of this legislature. It will arrive in your members' WhatsApp group shortly. Speaker, in this new normal, I'm going to first of all look back. And if I look back 1 year to Rocklands in Mitchell's Plain, that was where I delivered that State of the Province speech in a previous time, in a time before this new normal, in a time when COVID-19 was happening in another part of the world. It was happening in the Northern Hemisphere. And I think back to Mitchell's Plain and Rocklands. I think back to that site, a provincial heritage site. I could announce there that the minister and her team were working really hard so that the site could become a national heritage site. And even during this time of COVID-19, Minister Maria, thank you very much to you and your team in actually getting it declared through national government a national heritage site. And so today we find ourselves here in a different new normal, but also away from the seat of Parliament. Here also in a space of heritage in Genadendal, the Valley of Grace. It is such an honor and privilege to be here. But of course, that year between the SOPA last year and SOPA this year was really a very different year, a disruptive year. And of course, I'm actually standing here delivering a SOPA, but in actual fact, in October, because of that different year, I even delivered almost a mini SOPA, an in-between in October recovery plan because of where we found ourselves. So, Speaker, once again, can I thank you and the Programming Authority for continuing with your vision and mission of making sure we get out to the people. I also want to take this opportunity to say to you, Speaker, as I met you a bit earlier, you put in my hands and I've only had a chance to quickly look through it, a powerful book that talks about basic legal guide for kids. Really outstanding, and thank you for this. Also to thank you to Mr. Lewitz for putting it together, and I probably will be able to refer to it as we talk about recovery and the way forward, specifically how we need to look after our children. And perhaps that gives me the opportunity now to also send on this platform my deepest condolences to the parents of those young boys that lost their lives just a short while ago when that sand slope caved in on them, drowned in sand. A really devastating story, and my heartfelt, and I'm sure every single member here has heartfelt condolences to those families. Speaker, I would also like to convey my thanks to the school for allowing us to utilize this hall here today in Genadendal, to the governing body as well for making it available. This town, Genadendal, a place of inspiration and hope, a place of struggle, a place that played a prominent part in our history. Speaker, Genadendal is also like the Western Cape government, a place that has been leading from the front, but for a very long time, long before this parliament, this government, and long before our democratic dispensation was put in place, as you referred to in your opening remarks, Speaker. Speaker, this is the place of the first teachers' training college in our country. I was thinking about that after reading it from that wonderful book that Dr. Bailey sent to me, and I must thank him. Him and other citizens from Genadendal, both here, who have welcomed me and us with open arms. The calls, the messages. I got messages from people saying, thank you for coming to Genadendal. My great-great-grandfather built the church here. Or thank you for coming to Genadendal. My family come from here, and you know me because I serve on the board, but you actually know me from playing a role in the legal processes and our courts in Cape Town. This place, Genadendal, this place, this Valley of Grace, thank you very much to everyone from Genadendal for welcoming us and giving us the opportunity to utilize your town as the platform to talk about the state of our province and to talk about the future from this specific place. Thank you. I really value that. Speaker, I want to talk about, first of all, I think the biggest issue that is facing us as citizens of this province, citizens of Africa, and that is the COVID-19 battle that we are fighting. Members, honourable members, and citizens, this battle is long from over. We have gone through a year that has been unbelievable, ups and downs. We have gone through a year of great loss. We've gone through a year of unbelievable innovation. We've gone through a year, and I spoke about the mini SOPA, where we could talk about dealing with that first wave, and we could talk about the recovery plan and how our government had gone through a process, not only the provincial government, but linked through to the municipalities, because we'd developed a whole new way of working. Our municipalities and our government, our officials, be they at municipal level, at provincial level, or even at national level, have never, ever worked so closely together before. In the beginning of this pandemic, we were meeting sometimes three times a week in big plenary sessions online, as we are today, across this province, talking about our plans and our innovations and our mechanisms to deal with this pandemic. I then came to this house and tabled the recovery plan. And shortly after that, we had our second wave, twice as high as the first wave. An indication of the severity of that second wave was that it took us nearly 8 months for nearly 5,000 people in our province to succumb to this virus. Another 2.5 months later, and another 6,000 people succumbed to this virus. But also, in this great loss of life, loss of jobs, we also had amazing innovations that we can celebrate. And I want to use this opportunity once again to thank every single citizen in this province, every single frontline worker in this province who helped us get through that first wave and that second wave. We owe you so much. Thank you very much. But of course, as I said, this is by a long shot not over. And the elephant in the room, or the big thing that is facing us this year, is our way forward on vaccinations, our way forward on dealing with COVID-19 until we have immunity in our population, our way forward in dealing with a third wave. We have this four-pronged plan, or this four-pronged approach. And members, the first one is the successful rollout of vaccinations in our province, in our country. And this province will lead from the front. We will make sure that we are leading from the front with a world-class response to making sure we get as many vaccines into as many arms as possible, as quickly as possible. We've already started with that plan, and that plan is on our website. You can see it already. It is about making sure that we've got an oversight committee in place, that there are ethics in place, that we've got a proper plan on who gets vaccine first, our healthcare workers and frontline workers, those with comorbidities and elderly and people that are at risk, making sure that there's a proper plan on how we get people through the system so every single person in this province that needs a vaccination is going to get one efficiently and quickly. We will also make sure that you are registered, you've got a card, you are in this process, you understand with communication on how it's going to work, where you need to be, in the most remote village, the most remote town of this province, or in big vaccination centers in our cities and in our towns. We will make sure that we have nearly 4,000 vaccinators trained. We will make sure that those nearly 400 public sites are enabled and able to deliver those vaccines as quickly as possible. And we will also be doing this with the private sector. This will be a key partnership. The second part of this plan is our own procurement. Now, we know that already the information in the public domain is that in South Africa, we are procuring through a single government procurement process. And as I stand here today, we are around 40 million vaccinations, too few in the orders already placed for the rest of this year. For me, as the person who swore allegiance to the Constitution, who has a duty of care to the citizens of this province, I've got to go above and beyond just accepting that. And therefore, our cabinet has agreed that we will procure vaccines that cannot be supplied by the general supply that's coming from national government level, and we will fill that gap. I'm very happy to announce that that has already been approved by the cabinet. The procurement team themselves have already been put in place, that is with Treasury and the health procurement teams. And Dr. Kluti confirmed last Thursday that our procurement teams are already making calls to the CEOs of manufacturing companies around the world so that we can make sure that when we have the right vaccines approved by SAHPRA, that we can get as many vaccines into the system as possible so that every single person in this province gets vaccinated as quickly as possible so that we can move on. We can move forward. We can move forward and recover. The third part, Mr. Speaker, of this program, perhaps before I get there, one other thing about the procurement team is we will continue with our record of making sure every procurement and every process is made public. We will produce, as we have done with our PPE, a document that shows every company that supplies us with everything to do with vaccines is open to the public for scrutiny, how much we paid, where it came from, etc. We will make sure that we publish that expenditure plan for COVID-19. This is so we can avoid corruption. Speaker, the third part is the third wave mitigation. No matter how fast we get these vaccines into our system, we have a massive risk ahead of us. And that risk coming at us is the third wave. It's happening in other parts of the world as we speak. Other countries like us are ahead of us and they're in their third wave. We need to know that we will not have everyone vaccinated by the time we get to winter. And that is what the epidemiologists are telling us is the likelihood of that third wave starting as we change our seasons. And so we have to make sure that we continue to mitigate risk. We continue with our behavior change. We continue with making sure that we are predicting sufficient beds in place so that no one has to be without a hospital bed. We have to make sure that as we have shown in the first wave and the second wave with a world-class response, that we are able to do it again. We'll make sure, and we've signed the leases, extended the leases for our last remaining field hospital, which is on the R300, the Hospital of Hope. But all of those other extra beds that we put in place, a really smart move in making sure that the extra beds to deal with COVID-19 are not in field hospitals, but are actually in our existing health space. For example, the Hospital of Hope in Mitchell's Plain, the Frisia Ward and the Ward 99, the changes that were made to Genadendal Hospital, the changes that were made in George, in Hermanus, those changes were changes so we had enough beds for COVID-19, but they are also changes, permanent changes for the future. When you go to those hospital beds in Mitchell's Plain, there's piped oxygen to every single bed. So we have invested into infrastructure that is permanent and will make a permanent difference post-COVID-19. Then lastly in this four-pronged plan is therapeutics. The Minister of Health, Minister Mbombo, Dr. Kluti, and a couple of us met with SAHPRA last week, Friday. We met with SAHPRA purposefully because we wanted to understand the pipeline of approvals for vaccines because we want to procure those extra vaccines. We need to understand the process that is happening right now around the vaccine approvals and the vaccine trials. And we had a really great presentation. And Dr. Samete, thank you very much for that opportunity and for agreeing to continue to engage with us as a province. We also spoke about another side of our mitigation process, and that is about therapeutics. Because we stand out in this province when it comes to therapeutics. You remember dexamethasone, when everybody was under huge pressure and people were talking about how many people were not making it in our ICU centers, in our ICU beds. Dexamethasone, a therapeutic, came in and started to save lives. And it was the specialists, the researchers, and the doctors in our system that started to prescribe dexamethasone, and it made a massive difference and saved many lives. Not only medicinal, we also pioneered and worked very hard on making sure that we had high pressure nasal oxygen. And so all of a sudden, people were even getting care in our field hospitals. They didn't need to be in an ICU bed. Big differences through therapeutics. At the moment, the report back from SAHPRA was that there are hundreds of various studies going on at the moment, and there are quite a number of trials going on at the moment with therapeutics in our region. We have world-class researchers, professors in our universities that join with us and our department in our training hospitals, and those very special people are working day and night to make sure that these therapeutics are there for us as well to mitigate as much risk into the third wave as possible. And perhaps there I must say to the citizens who send me hundreds of emails and messages, and I'm sure all of you as well, honorable members, on ivermectin. I'm happy that part of that discussion to tell you that a partnership between Stellenbosch University and UCT and those really special people are busy right now with a trial in our region on ivermectin. Everything that we do in our government must be based on data, must be evidence-led, and also, in our case of medicinal practices, must be approved. And of course, that also through SAHPRA, allowing doctors to be able to do research, but also in enabling this environment so that these therapeutics can be put in place as we move towards this third wave. And then finally, in our challenge in dealing with COVID-19 and this pandemic, it is the rollout of this new trial that has now been extended to our office today at around about 20 past 12. The first four healthcare workers will get a vaccine. It'll be the Johnson & Johnson trial vaccine. And I think that is a great, absolutely. It is something that we can really celebrate. Today, those vaccines will start in Khayelitsha at our Khayelitsha Hospital, in Tigerberg at our Tigerberg Hospital, and in Krutaskir at our Krutaskir Hospital. Minister Mbombo will be there to start with that first round of vaccines. I must apologize to her that I would not be able to complete the speech and get back there in time. I would have loved to have been there with her, but as we are today in this new normal, I will follow online as those first vaccines are administered to some of those frontline health care workers. I want to thank everybody that's involved in the Johnson & Johnson rollout. I want to specifically recognize Professor Becker. She came and spent some time on our DigiCon last Thursday, and when you listened to her, you knew that in our 11 sites of these trials in this province, at our 11 sites, our team there, we're in good hands. We are part of a trial. Remember that this still has to be formally approved in our country, but at least this approval of this trial enables our frontline healthcare workers to be right in front of getting these protections in their arms, these vaccines in their arms. I also want to say that I had a great opportunity last week to meet with the consul generals and ambassadors, which we normally do in a brunch, and this time again we had to do it online, We normally do it at this time of the year. And it was a great opportunity to engage with the world and say to the world that we are also looking, if anybody's got extra vaccines, as long as they're within our approval process. And of course, we've got partners around the world also helping us make sure that we get sufficient vaccines. If we've got 40 million vaccines too few in our country, we need to definitely make sure that we move up and get that done as quickly as possible. So moving on from our big challenge, COVID-19, it is about this state of the province and looking forward. I've said it's going to be a very difficult year. But again, just as we've shown in the last year, this province is going to lead from the front. But what I want to say is that something has really amazed me. When we started speaking about procuring a shortfall, I listened to the noise out there. I listened to the people raising issues about whether we should be able to or not. We're a constitutional democracy in our country. And our constitution, first of all, says that we have a co-competence in healthcare. We have a competence in our government to make sure that our citizens have the best healthcare we can give them. And so that baffled me, that we weren't able to stand up and, as I swore that allegiance of care to our citizens. But of course, it goes further than that. It's about us fighting for more federal powers, and specifically when national government fails. When national government is failing us, we need to step up as a government. Our constitution says that in actual fact, the power should be moved to local governments and provincial governments if the competency is there to deliver that service, deliver it closer to the people, not in Pretoria. Deliver it on site, closer to the people. And we will continue to fight for more federal powers. We've shown in the past, we've written our own legislation on oversight of policing, on the ombudsman, and I'll talk a little bit more about that a bit later. We've written our own education laws, and I'll also mention that a little bit later. We started processes in this province on skills development, getting apprenticeships back in place, where national government made a decision that apprenticeships were out. We will only focus on an FET college system. In this province, 11 and a half years ago, we started pushing the boundaries on skills, on making sure that apprentices and partnerships between business and those that need skills were brought back in. And I'm really happy to say that while this province was pushing, we're seeing those changes now happening at a national government level. And of course, that's what a democracy is about. That's what using your provincial vote is all about. And we will continue to push for more and more federal powers. And I think this province led from the front many years ago when our national government, also in the health space, were denialists around HIV and AIDS. And in this very province, we led from the front. We led in making sure that antiretrovirals were given so that there was no longer transmission of mother to child when mothers were giving birth and they were HIV positive. We led that change, and we will continue to do so and do again. I also want to say as we move on that, and last thing on fighting COVID-19, is that we need to make sure that we understand every one of our responsibilities. You know, when the state steps in and puts lockdown in place, it takes away our freedoms. And we get angry about that. And when we open up a little bit more and a bit more, we give freedom back to people. But with freedom comes responsibility. And I want to use this opportunity to say to each and every citizen of this province, I know how difficult it is to wear that mask. It is not easy. We get so tired of it. I do. But please, these basic, cost-effective mechanisms make massive differences in protecting each and every one of us, in protecting the most vulnerable in our system. Please, as we move forward, I want us to continue to lead from the front as a province. I really want us, we just have to do what we know what to do. We've done it before. We need to keep doing it. As we move towards a third wave, as we bring in vaccines, as we bring in more healthcare, those are what we are doing as a government. That's our part of the deal. We need every citizen to continue with their part of the deal. It's a small, small thing to offer up. There's a klein opoffering on our journey this year, this tough year ahead. Please continue, as difficult as it is, to lead the way in making sure we mitigate risk. So, honourable members, I've said for the last year that we're actually fighting two pandemics. Pandemic number one is what I've just been speaking about. Pandemic number two. Pandemic number two is a humanitarian crisis. It is a crisis of hunger. It is a crisis of poverty. It is a crisis of a nation and a province where people are getting poorer. We have to put as much energy into the second pandemic. We have to put innovation. We have to put everything that we can into the second pandemic to find that balance. We have to do that, and that is what this speech is going to talk about. It is what I spoke about in October. I will talk about some of the projects that we've put in place, some of the delivery already in place, but I will also talk about how we go forward. It will be a challenging year. It will be a year where we need to make sure that we continue to fight for jobs, because jobs are the best antidote on crime. Jobs helps fight crime. A job, nothing like a job, helps someone out of poverty and hunger. And nothing like a job ultimately brings back dignity to someone and their family. So going forward, honorable members, we've got to make sure that we tackle the second pandemic with just as much vigor. So the recovery plan, and I spoke about it in October, just only 4 months ago. And if I think 4 months back, we put this recovery plan in place, and as we were starting to get things going, we had to really revert back and focus on managing the second wave. But last year alone, if we're thinking about this side of pandemic number two, 270,000 people in our province lost their job. 270,000 people. You know, for me, it's really painful because for the last 10 years in the executive office spaces that I've played in this government, I've been a key part of enabling and creating enabling environments so that we continue to grow jobs, narrow the Gini coefficient, work really hard at making those differences. And of course, these kind of setbacks are really hard to deal with. I'm happy to say that in the third quarter of last year, we managed to claw back 37,000 jobs. But that's nowhere near enough. We've got to continue to really push hard as we fight this second pandemic. We've got to make sure that we continue to create that ecosystem, because that's what we believe in. Create the ecosystem so that the private sector, entrepreneurs, so that they can go out there and do what they do best. Start businesses, grow businesses, create jobs. We need to continue to support those entrepreneurs. We need to continue to cut red tape. We need to continue to invest in things like broadband. We need to continue to support incubators. We need to continue to support those SMMEs. And specifically for me, I think that is the toughest part of what's happening in our environment today, is those small businesses that are taking the brunt of what is happening globally and what is happening in our country and in this province as our economy slows down because of pandemic number one. So, Speaker, how far or how much have we managed to achieve in the last 4 months? Well, first of all, I'd like to talk about the recovery plan and some of the economic interventions. Just the other day, I had a huge opportunity to go out to Linguletu Kashtol, a spaza shop in Khayelitsha. I went there to go and have a look at one of those plans that we spoke about 4 months ago, which we said we're going to roll out vouchers. We want to roll out a voucher system that can act as a system where someone who's feeding someone in a feeding scheme can get a voucher. They get a voucher on their phone, and they can redeem that voucher from a local shop, a local spaza shop. And when I visited this program, I managed to meet Mpumi. Now, Mpumi's got a kitchen, and she feeds around 250 either young people or elderly every single, three times a week, sorry. And Mpumi gets a voucher on her phone. She gets it every second week. And she takes that voucher and she goes along to Lingoletu Cash Store and she redeems her voucher there and she gets her samp and her beans and her all of her product that she uses. When you go back to her facility, which is a space that she's managed to get from one of the local ECDs, and you can see her menu up on the wall, and she's got her menu there, and she's proudly delivering meals in a dignified way to citizens of our province. But this is an intervention where our Economics Development Department creates a voucher that you can download on your phone. There's no cash involved to be stolen on your way to the store. You get to the store can redeem that voucher. And there's a couple of million rand spent on this pilot project, and we now, in our budget, Minister Mania is going to probably speak about how we can roll this out further. But when I looked at it, I saw huge opportunity, not only for getting businesses and NGOs to work together with a voucher system and keep small businesses going. How do we link that through to our incubator in Khayelitsha, where at the barn in Khayelitsha, our young techies can start to develop programs, because at Pumi's, she actually writes down everyone's name that comes to get a meal. Surely, and she said most people are regulars. Surely you don't have to rewrite their names every time. Surely we can have an app that can scan you, or an app that can actually be used that other NGOs can use. Perhaps this is a system that we've got donor fatigue in our system now, but donors might say, but through this app, I'm really happy to make a contribution to Pumi's Kitchen, because I know that this meal is going to be delivered to people who need it most. We've also in the last while, and this is a pilot, and those pilots actually lead to much bigger things. If I think about the partnership that we've got going in the city of Cape Town with the German government and the VPUU, they put in 50 million rand that are going to be used in the using voucher systems. And they've just agreed now to actually double that going into the new financial year. Speaker and honorable members, in the last months, we've done more than just that. 39 million rand has gone to 250 SMMEs. I spoke about those SMMEs who are under serious threat, saving 2,041 jobs. A voucher system was created that a stipend could be paid to wine, to people in the wine tourism industry who were losing their jobs, and 1,165 people who were just about to lose their job in the wine industry got a voucher, and those jobs were saved. 4.7 million rand was used by the Department of Arts and Culture to help our artists, to help those involved, our people involved in our arts and our culture and our heritage environment. 753 applicants got help through that funding. Thank you very much. That made a massive difference on sustaining someone's dignity in this process as we move forward. We managed to get 25,000 deeds that were blocked in a backlog in our deeds office, unblocked, and enabled those deeds to flow through. A deed of sale really does stop funding moving from one partner to another, one seller from a buyer to a seller. 3,500 youth at work placements were made. We had, I think, an outstanding project was the 35,000 tourists that were repatriated. These tourists are going to come back and visit us again. The fast tracking of EIAs to make sure that those processes still get going, even though we're under different management systems in this new normal. The work that's been done in the Port of Cape Town to make sure that our exports that were going out could flow out freely, because everybody had to work under new environments under COVID-19. The work done at the George Airport to enable that airport to open up and bring in at least local tourists from around our country and allow the economy in some way to recover. Speaker, also going forward in recovery, we need to have a look at how we can create further jobs through infrastructure. Now, 4 months ago, I spoke about setting up an infrastructure authority. I'm very happy to say that that technical process is already underway, and thank you very much to the teams at Treasury and within our infrastructure departments of pulling that together. Those technical processes are underway. Remember, when you ask to put an authority together, it's not something that just happens tomorrow. From here, the next stage is the appointment of some a panel of infrastructure specialists and experts to advise us that we are on the right track. And of course, that has to come to Cabinet in the next few months. Once we have passed it in Cabinet, we then have to put enabling legislation. And of course, that's where the members come in. They will have a role to play in making sure we get that enabling legislation in place. Then we also at the same time need to get National Treasury approval, because you cannot set up an entity without approval from National Treasury. And that will then enable us to borrow money in order to actually use infrastructure as a key mechanism of getting our economy going again. So thank you very much for the work that has been done in that space. We will once again lead in making sure that we build partnerships across our province and across governments in our province. On that point of infrastructure, what I also want to say is that, DG, thank you very much for putting that meeting together yesterday with Dr. Ramakgopa. Dr. Ramakgopa is the head of the President's infrastructure team that he's put in place, and yesterday I had an opportunity to engage with that team and spend a short while with our team. And, you know, it's quite amazing. In actual fact, I was blown away by having a look at the presentations from our team to this infrastructure team from the presidency, to see what's in the pipeline, to look at the immediates, the long terms, and they were from roads, from our transport and public department, to long-term visions of N7 bridges. We spoke about the RDZs and the SEZs. We spoke about school infrastructure, which is under huge pressure at the moment because of cutting of budgets. We had the education department there, the health department there. We had our infrastructure department there, led by Transport and Public Works. We had the Premier's department. We had Treasury there. And it was amazing to see all of those presentations. I wasn't able to be there for every single one of them. But I want to publicly here say to Dr. Ramakgopa and his team, thank you very much for the engagement. And we will continue to engage with you in making sure that infrastructure continues to be that lever that we need so desperately. But of course, when speaking about infrastructure, let's also talk about an infrastructure that is under severe pressure and has been for a long time and still is. And that is our rail infrastructure. And that is why we've said that we need to create the single transport authority for the Greater Cape Town. Rail is a backbone of any economy. We're in a rural area. If rail was fully operational here, and I'll talk a little bit more about agriculture and exports, but rail should be that backbone that gets all of our exports to our harbor, or our harbors, should I say. Rail is a backbone infrastructure in our economy, in the city region, of moving people efficiently, cost effectively, and safely. But unfortunately, that is broken at the moment. And so I want to say that we need an authority. This again, in devolving power to provinces and cities and city regions. And it's not only us in the Western Cape that's pushing for this. The Premier in Gauteng is doing exactly the same thing. And we will be doing exactly that, working with PRASA. And I want to thank Minister Madikizela and the chair, the new chair of the PRASA board, for the engagements and the leadership and the number of meetings we've had just in the last month, and how that is being pulled together, and it seems to be a new energy. And I really do welcome that. We will push for this infrastructure, because this infrastructure is what's going to help us enable the economy and bring dignity to our people. We have already, now in the last 4 months, as part of this recovery plan now, signed the MOU with PRASA, and we've already put the first 10 million rand from our side towards this partnership in making sure that we are building safe corridors. We're making sure that we are working at the yards, the stations, and getting specifically right now that central line back up and running. Speaker, while continuing with transport and rail being a backbone, we also need to make sure that we support the taxi industry, because the taxi industry is the next layer in that public transport space. Sad to see people being shot yesterday in Bellville as part of these taxi conflicts. And I need the police to make sure that we act swiftly and decisively. We cannot have this. This is not how you sort out disputes in an industry. But from our side, We want to continue to build that relationship. And I spoke about it in October, about the red dot system, that innovation that came out of our Transport and Public Works Department, and that red dot system where 100 taxis and a taxi union formed a partnership with government, where we're normally looking at fighting with each other around policy and licensing. Suddenly we're partnering with each other, and more than 110,000 healthcare workers transported safely to and from work. That partnership led to some work in our department, and a pilot project is going to be launched later in the next month or so by Minister Madikizela, the Blue Dot system, where again, we will partner with the taxi industry using technology as a platform, making sure that we build incentives into the system for efficiency, for safe, cost-effective ways of getting citizens in a public transport system going forward. These are the kind of innovative and leading from the front ways that we need to be putting in place constantly to make a difference for the citizens of this province. Speaker, this province is also going to become the first province to avoid load shedding. Load shedding has been around for years. Load shedding is going to be around for years to come. A massive failure of a state-owned entity, a massive failure of national government controlling and managing that entity. And quite frankly, we have to make sure that we enable this environment differently. Part of the meeting with Dr. Ramakgopa was talking about Atlantis, the special economic zone, where in the zone we're going to be putting our own energy system in place. But also, we've been speaking about it for so long. We in this province have already done the EIA in Atlantis for the Unkelig power station. Let's get that gas to power station in place. And they are out there today busy having a look, and we need to push that. We need to make sure that wherever possible, we continue to find alternative ways of energy in, of bringing energy into our system and into our grids. Load shedding, like COVID, slows down our economy. It costs us, for every level of load shedding in our economy in this province, 75 million rand every day per level that is load shed. And that is unacceptable, especially when we're trying to grow back and build back what we've lost over the last year. We committed to 20 million rand over the, per year over the next 2 years from our government to local governments to say to them, how can we help you? Because it's at local government that you have grids. It's at local government level that we are now going to be able to move from 1 megawatt to 10 megawatts and enable you to put in your own energy systems. And here I want to really congratulate the 6 municipalities in our province that are already moving in that direction and are going to make use of this money. I also want to take this opportunity to congratulate Stellenbosch Municipality for announcing that they want to become the first town in our province not to be load shed. And of course, I really look forward to the competition between Stellenbosch and the municipalities here in the Overberg, because maybe one of these municipalities are going to pip them to the post. Because that's exactly what we've got to do. We've got to work really hard to make sure that our municipalities get us out of load shedding. What better way to attract investment than to be able to announce that you do not have load shedding in your municipality? I also want to use this opportunity to congratulate Hessequa, because they were the first municipality to put a solar-powered desalination plant in place. We need more of these across more of our municipalities. I also want to say to the City of Cape Town, well done. The City of Cape Town has been working on this for many years. We know that there are already thousands of independent power producers already in the City of Cape Town with solar panels on homes and on businesses, putting power back into the grid. That's why, alongside those small embedded generation units and the hydroelectric power unit and the mechanism to actually get businesses to tone or slow down some of their use, we can actually avert a whole countrywide lockdown level. So when South Africa is in lockdown level one, the citizens of Cape Town don't realize it, but they're not in lockdown, load shedding level one, they don't even notice it. When the country goes into two, the City of Cape Town only goes into one. Let's start to see that in our municipalities, and very shortly, let's see that we actually move forward and become the province in South Africa. Let's lead from the front that does no longer have load shedding. I also want to talk about innovation and specifically in agriculture. In agriculture, I, being the Minister of Agriculture for some time, a few years ago, it is a sector that's really close to my heart, but also understanding that I remember while I was the Minister, we had a massive drought in our region. And just like fighting COVID-19, when I, back then we were fighting a zero, we were fighting drought and making sure that we were enabling and innovating and enabling our industry to get beyond the drought. It is really exciting that while the world's economy, our country's economy, and our province's economy has been so hard hit by COVID-19, it is really exciting to see that the agricultural sector now has had a chance to show different, to show that they can make that difference in our region. And it is unbelievable to see what those last rains have done for us in the province, what that innovation has enabled, and what that real energy and chutzpah that our agricultural sector has enabled us in the last while to show record growth. 18.5% growth in the agricultural sector last year. 18.5% when the rest of the country, when the rest of the sectors in our province were in deep, deep trouble. I want to congratulate every single person in the sector for everything that they have done to help us with food security, to help with our balance of trade, to increase those exports. You guys are amazing. Thank you very much. While saying that, I must also then perhaps even within that sector highlight the citrus sector specifically. A record in citrus exports. 146 million cartons of citrus were exported out of this region last year. And you know, I want to say a little bit more about the citrus industry. When I was visiting with Minister Mbombo up the West Coast the other day, the health system, because we now, as you remember, the COVID-19 spread wasn't evenly spread. It was happening in different regions at different times, in different provinces at different times. And in our province, it moved across to the West Coast probably as a district last. But the interesting thing is, when the first wave was hitting the garden route, the second wave was hitting the garden route, in the West Coast, they were in their citrus season and coming out of their citrus season, where thousands and thousands of agri workers were moving into the province and moving into that region to go and help with harvest. The health department, the health system, and the agricultural department and the agricultural system worked together. They created bubbles on farms so that those bubbles didn't spread the virus to other bubbles. They put systems in place in fields to make sure that they minimize risk. And by doing that, it was quite amazing because one would have expected that to be a super spreader event, when in actual fact, super spreaders were funerals, or weddings, or people staying too long in a nightclub together. And here, thousands of people moving into a region to earn a living and actually disciplined processes in place. So not just congratulations on your export record, but also on the way that you've managed COVID-19 in your region. I think it has been absolutely outstanding. Speaker, I also want to just end off with talking about agriculture, and we speak on about agricultural innovation so often, and we have been doing it for years, you know, whether it's smart pens or fruit looks or... But the department keeps on innovating, keeps on doing amazing things, and today I must just recognize them for how they're leading at the moment with drone pilot training, because drones are playing such an important role in the agricultural sector. And really happy to mention Herman Nonkonyana, Chris Mankies, and Stefan Teron, who were the first to become drone pilots, along with 13 others in the pipeline of becoming drone pilots at our in-house training facility. And I believe the next round of drone pilots are being trained. And that shows that we're also moving to make sure that we're using technology and innovation. And when you use technology and innovation like agriculture have been doing, then what happens is we get those record harvests. We use less water. We really do become a world leader. And again, the agricultural sector in this province leads from the front. While talking about agriculture, we must also talk about green jobs, green economy, and specifically climate change. Because climate change is something that is affecting us drastically in our province and has been for a long time. And here again, I think the work over the last years must be recognized, not only just in the agricultural sector, but our Department of Environmental Affairs, Minister Bridell, I recognize the Green Cape initiative and all the work that has happened in Green Cape, creating the green economy of our region, the work that ended up through the city and the province and national government with the IDZ or the SEZ in Atlantis. And that really is exciting to see in the kind of investments that's going into Atlantis, but I'll say a bit more about that just now. But really that green economy and working very hard. In agriculture, committing now 10,000 hectares giving to rehabilitation. In other words, looking at how we get it back, get nature to come back into those systems and removing alien vegetation, 1,000 green jobs going in there. But of course, continuing the work on climate change. And another part that I think is really great that our government has got the opportunity to welcome a new professor, a professional in our system, Professor Stephanie Midgley, who is going to be joining our government in making sure that we stay ahead of the game, making sure that our climate change responses are also leading from the front. Congratulations to everybody in those departments that work together around climate change. Then, Speaker, I must speak about tourism. I think tourism is probably the sector that's been the hardest hit in our country and in our region. It is the sector that has the most SMMEs. It has so many small businesses that perhaps won't even be considered tourism businesses because they are in the value chain and the supply line of those tourism businesses. They don't have the luxury of saying we are able to mothball a hotel and we'll open it up again in October, things improve. They don't have those opportunities. It is about jobs today, food, feeding your family today, and those, every single one of those small businesses have really been hard hit, specifically around our coastal economy and our coastal towns who don't have the opposite side of the agricultural sector really doing well, and of course, relying so heavily on tourism. I want to say to the department, thank you very much for all the work that you and Minister Mania have been doing in creating programs, in marketing, in changing the way that we go out and sell tourism, in making sure that we actually get that balance right, because I think we were tending to focus too much on international, and now international tourism, specifically for the next year to year and a half, is going to be very constrained. So we really need to do a lot more work on local tourism. And this is where the province, where Westgro, our economics departments, this is where our local governments and our tourism authorities and our local governments come in. But this is where the tourism sector, those SMMEs. I went and spoke to some people here in Genadendal before coming in here this morning. People were talking about tourism and tourism opportunities. Just spend half an hour in this very town and it hits you. This should be one of our tourism gems in South Africa. We need to actually have a look at how we market this place differently, how we enable jobs here for the people of Genadendal using tourism. And what better time now than while we get local tourism to enable it? How do we get more people of this province who've never been here before to come and visit? Order. Thank you very much, Honourable Member. I just said, as I started this thing, I went and spoke to the people outside just before coming in, and we spoke about tourism. We spoke about tourism.
Order, Honourable Members. Order, please proceed, Honourable Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'll use the opportunity to take another sip of water. While we are promoting domestic tourism, and this is what that opportunity, and not only domestic, but I think also regional tourism, I want to thank again the Air Access team. This team has been around for a while, but it's quite interesting that now, during a hard lockdown and during the period after that going into a second wave, this team weren't sitting at home, this team weren't relaxing, this team were out there actually putting more and more pressure on the system. And during the last year, during the last couple of months, this team were able to secure the second direct flight to the United States. So in November, we've got a second direct flight, one going from Cape Town directly into Atlanta, a Delta Airlines flight. That means we've now secured two direct flights into the US market. They have continued to work with those airlines who...
Point of order, Speaker.
Honourable Premier, will please take your seat.
Speaker rule.
Honourable Member, please rise as you address the presiding officer. What's your point of order?
Yeah, Speaker, rule of conduct in the public area is clear, bullet six, and we are allowing people to participate. Thank you, Chair. Speaker.
Honourable Members, thank you, Honourable Van Vogen. Honourable Members, I would like to draw attention to the directives as passed by this House, which were published on the 23rd of April, 2020, that there are no interjections when we are hosting the sitting virtually. No interjections permitted whatsoever. And it was a decision of this House by all of us. And this is in line and, of course, in keeping with our standing rules, Rule 40, that we actually respect that protocol. So it's not my wish to curtail the right of the members to engage. So tomorrow there will be a debate in response to the State of the Province address, and that will be the opportunity for the honourable members to indulge. Honourable Premier, please proceed. Please take your seat, Honourable Premier. Apologies. What is your point of order, Honourable Dagmo?
Thank you very much, Speaker. Speaker, as I understand it, we are today not in a virtual session. This is a hybrid session. So we understand very clearly that when we are having a virtual session, dan word ons gevra dat ons nie moet met tussenwerpsels moet kom. Maar hier is ons in een kamer, ander mense sit daar in die Kaap. So waar is die reël wat sê dat in 'n sogenaamde hybrid session ons nie kan interject, soos ons sê. Ek wil vra waar in die reëls sê dat by 'n hybrid session ons kan nie interjections maak nie.
Thank you, Honorable Dagmo. On the 18th of March, 2020. That is where we started off with the approach of minimizing contact, also doing things differently as Parliament. But Rule 1 of the standing rules make provision for the Speaker to make determination for which the standing rules don't make that provision. So I'm consistent with the rules, that is Rule 1. And of course, the directives which we all agreed to on the 23rd of April 2020 gave meaning to that. So the difficulty, we're not in a hybrid session of nothing. It's a hybrid session of a virtual session. The hybrid begins to make sense when other people are here, other members are here physically, and other members are connecting virtually. So as long as there's a virtual component, we may not. Because what then happens is that it becomes disruptive for those honorable members who are at home connecting virtually, and for the honorable members who are in the chamber connecting from the chamber in Cape Town. And of course, there's other platforms where stakeholders, as we sit here, honorable members, are connected to this SOPA. So I would like to really implore the honorable members to exercise some restraint. I know it can be very tempting, but let us allow for the honorable premier to proceed and ensure that there's order in this sitting.
Speaker.
I've made my ruling and I proceed. There is no further points of order in this particular point.
Speaker, if you allow things to happen point today, tomorrow you would...
There is no further points of order in this point. If there is another point, it will be on another point. I've ruled on this matter and I consider the matter closed. Please take your seats. Thank you. Honourable Premier, please proceed.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Speaker. I think lastly, I just want to say to the team at Westgrow, the Air Access team, also to the new flights that have gone into Africa, specifically Harare and Walvis Bay, that are going to be opening up later this year. Thank you very much for the work you're doing there. And of course, as I said, we need to continue now with really focusing on local tourism campaigns, local tourism marketing. Let's find cost-effective and amazing experiences that our local regular citizens can actually get out there and enjoy our tourism ecosystem and our tourism market. I think it is going to be a really good move to make sure that we are sustainable and also grow the sector over the next year. It's going to be tough, but we all have to play our part. Speaker, then one other item around tourism is we're going to be lobbying the President and the Minister of Home Affairs, Minister Motsoaledi, to look at giving us a new remote working visa. I don't know if you've seen, honourable members, but there was an article where the Cape or Cape Town was rated as one of the 50 best cities to work in remotely. That is an opportunity, and of course you must maximise on your opportunities. And I know that this is true because the other day I was going for a cycle Sunday morning and stopped for a quick coffee, as one does. And I chatted to a guy that was there and asked, and he said that he was in the bed and breakfast business. And he'd invested his funds, his pension or whatever he'd invested, but he'd bought bed and breakfasts. And he said that first lockdown came and he was absolutely destroyed. He had to retrench everybody, and he was in deep, deep trouble. But that's when innovation comes in, and what he did was he went and put high-speed broadband connections into his bed and breakfasts, and he advertised in Europe and said, come and work from Cape Town during your winter. Come here to our summer. And so he said to me that when the first wave lockdown ended, he managed to put a bit more investment into his business, and he is now fully booked, and he is fully booked at 3-month bookings at a time. And this is exactly what we need to be doing right now. We need to find new innovative ways of getting people to rent our spaces, and what better way of doing it when we're actually getting dollars, pounds, euros, into our system at the same time. So we will be pitching for that visa system that actually enables this even more. And can you imagine if Cape Town was voted as one of the 50 best places for remote working? Can you imagine what's going to happen when you can advertise some of our rural towns who've got even more to offer, and especially people who want to get away from Europe, who want to get away from the hustle and bustle, and probably right now also want to get away from COVID-19. Imagine coming here to Genadendal and spending 2 or 3 months and being able to remotely work wherever you are in the world. I'll talk a little bit more about broadband in Genadendal just now. But I really want to say that I think this is also part of how we need to be innovating and moving forward with making sure that we lead from the front, but making sure that we enable our economy. We also want to grow exports. I've spoken about those record exports of the agricultural sector. We need to grow that even further. Now, on the back of those record exports, again, the trend has been bucked here in the Western Cape on the back of those whopping new numbers from agriculture. And our exports out of our region have grown in the last quarter on quarter, by 49%. Growth quarter on quarter, 49% in exports. That is phenomenal. That really is unbelievable. I spoke about some of the work that we did in the port, and there's some new port management in place, and I want to thank the port management and, of course, our teams in working together to make sure that even during these difficult times of COVID-19, we found efficiencies in the system so that we could get our product into those international markets. And also, despite some of the lockdowns and some of the difficult environment, we managed to achieve numbers like this. I also want to, in this space, congratulate the teams at Westgrow and Economic Development with their virtual trade missions. So because we can't go on trade missions now, they've developed ways of doing it. And so they have virtual trade missions. And they've set themselves a target to grow trade by an extra $4 billion through these virtual trade missions. We've also, as I said, been working with the Port of Cape Town. And perhaps lastly, I'd like to say that there's a lot of work happening now with our airport. We know it's an award-winning airport. And at that airport, we are now seen as an air cargo hub. And we're now going to really work on how do we get high-value product into the belly of those planes that are flying in and out. That is a natural movement. We always focused in airlift on making sure that we are getting people here. But of course, it's about a mixture of how do you get people backwards and forwards on those planes, but you've got to make sure you've got value underneath. And so air cargo, and you also know that the airlift program is not only a government-funded program. When we put that together, we said this is a public-private funded partnership. And the partnership is national government, provincial government, local government, in the form of the airport, the province, municipalities as partners, but it is also private sector driven. And as part of that air cargo hub drive, it's really nice to see that DHL have now our newest funding partner who've come on helping with those air access programs. And thank you. We really welcome them. And I congratulate the team on all the work that they are doing. Of course, that's the recovery is the economic space. Now we need to make sure that we continue and attract investment. We've got to land this investment into our system, and it's also not easy. And it's specifically not easy when we have a national government with failing policies, with unchecked corruption, with a lack of good governance, with divided leadership. The ecosystem that creates is a really difficult environment in which to attract foreign direct investment. But here we've got a stable government. We've got a platform that shows good governance. Congratulations once again, DG, to you and to the HODs across our government for continually pushing those boundaries and coming home with those Batopele Awards of best-run departments in our country. Those audit outcomes that we keep on getting, those show that a government has got that good governance stability in the system. And that gives confidence to investors. And again, there, I've spoken earlier about the SEZ and the IDZ. Specifically, the IDZ launched not that long ago, 120 hectares of developable land in the IDZ. And we've just landed 680 million rands worth of investments into that region, taking up already 25 hectares of the 120 hectares. Green Cape and Westgrow and the IDZ working on bringing in investments into the region. And again, they've in the last year brought in 7 billion rands worth of investment. And we need to make sure that we do that and set that target to do that again. And perhaps also just to say, even in this ecosystem and in this environment we find ourselves in with COVID-19, with that national environment that people are wary about, just this last week, we've had a tourism investment that our team has been facilitating, almost a billion rand single tourism investment at this time. In that same week, a BPO came in who's been invested in the Philippines for many years, and has said now they need to have a look at this market. This market really looks interesting for them. And also, I think on the back of the world-class response in pharmaceutical in COVID-19 and our research capabilities and our medical hospitals linked in with government, we've had some really interesting discussions on some pharmaceutical investments that will be coming shortly, looking at manufacture of vaccines, looking at other vaccines and other medicinal manufacture that can take place in this region, in the southern tip of Africa. We've got to keep making sure that we get investment, both South African internal investment and also continue with foreign direct investment. Then as part of the recovery plan, it's about jobs, but it's also about safety. And we will continue rolling out our safety plan. And I think perhaps for me, you know, in that picture that's up on the screen, when we had the rollout of our law enforcement officers in Athlone Stadium, that was really an outstanding moment in my time as Premier. And thanks to Minister Fritz and the team at Docs and the team at the City of Cape Town, I really want to thank you for continuing. This year, again, we will continue with another 500 law enforcement or lead officers. 250 will start their training on the 1st of April, and then on the 1st of June, the next 250 for deployment in July and deployment in October later this year. Again, when you walk the streets with these officers, there you really start to see the impact of the safety plan. When you can look into the eyes of citizens standing at their gates, and they know that this intervention is going to start to bring them safety, because that intervention is done and based on data and evidence, and it's zooming into the murder hotspots of our region. And I also want to say that this is how we're going to tackle murder, how we're going to tackle gangs. But of course, it's also about rolling it out into the future. I want to thank the team. We are going to, on top of those law enforcement or LEAP officers, we are also rolling out another 1,000 safety ambassadors in our region. We are also rolling out peace officers. Peace officers will be going into municipalities outside of the city of Cape Town because the murder hotspots are all in 10 of those policing precincts all end up in the city of Cape Town. But 6 vulnerable municipalities are going to get these peace officers. And Minister Fritz says to me that it's not about something that is happening or to come. 57 have already been trained and are already being rolled out, and they are in Prince Albert, in Laingsburg, and in Beaufort West. Also, we have now got 69 vehicles from Public Works and Transport, 69 vehicles that are now part of the highway patrol system, and it was good to see them even out on the highway today coming here. This is about making sure that we're managing these conduits or these routes, because every single facet of government, we need to be playing a role in how we make it safer, and specifically the transportation of drugs and illegal substances, they all travel through our road networks, and we've got to make sure that our traffic system is aligned to the partnering with the SAP systems and our law enforcement systems at our municipalities, and make sure we bring that together. I was in the West Coast again the other day, and I saw the control room that's being put in place to bring the West Coast together. I hope while I'm here in the Overberg, Mr. Mayor, that I can actually get to see some of the interventions from the funding that we give through from a provincial level to this region, that we bring our towns together in the interest of building safety in our region. As part of the safety plan as well, changing or bringing some change to the alcohol legislation. And I think that we always say that we're data-led and data and evidence led and driven. The data that we used in the management of the blunt tool called lockdown and banning of alcohol, that is a tool that's used now. We submit that and it gets used by the presidency and by the National Minister of Health. We roll that out in 5 of our hospitals. We're now going to be rolling that out to 20 of our hospitals in the province so that we get better granular data and detail. I also want to say that that kind of data on managing to measure trauma is critical. And so for us, as legislators, that's what we do. As members of this, our job is to pass laws and regulation. And so again, we will be bringing a change to the liquor regulations. And I think that's taught us many lessons, and we must draw from those lessons to say, how can we create an environment through regulation and legislation that enables us to get better behavior change? Because at the end of the day, this is behavior change that we need. We need to make sure that we change how citizens and their relationship with alcohol, because we don't need them to end up in our trauma beds and in our trauma units and actually putting other citizens at risk. The linkages through to crime and murder, but also the linkages through to gender-based violence. And on that point, I want to thank Minister Fernandes. First of all, the 6 shelters that we got given from the National Department of Public Works, they've now been refurbished, and those 6 shelters are now ready for operation. I also want to thank her very much for 40 days ago, or 4 months ago, we said that we were going to also roll out extra social workers. Those social workers now have also been rolled out. And these social workers are to add specifically to help women who suffer because of gender-based violence. The social workers are there to also make sure that we are there in the evenings and on weekends, and using that data to understand when are the times that you actually need that support and where do you need that support? What do the heat maps look like in measuring this data around gender-based violence so we can actually put the resources where they are needed? And then we can also come with mechanisms to find behavioral change. I also want to say we must continue to identify young men and intervene into that space. We look at Chrysalis and the success of that project, but I also want to say to the minister, to her team of social workers, 46,000 citizens have received support in trauma support in the last year. That they continue to do that, and I want to thank them, every single one of them. They're really special people who go out, give people support in really trying and testing times. And of course, continue to identify those young boys at risk so we can actually change their future and their path. We will continue also upgrading and updating and innovating with our data system so that we remain data-led and evidence-led and data-driven. I also want to say that, as I said earlier, we put legislation in place that enabled us, not from only an oversight of a DOCS point of view, but also the ombudsman. And we're going to bring a change in legislation. I need the parliament to get that as soon as possible. While we have IPED, who has an oversight over SAPS, our ombudsman also can have oversight over SAPS. But we also need to make sure our ombudsman has oversight over these LEAP deployed officers, over our law enforcement officers, and over any of those gaps in the system. If we don't have proper oversight in place, we also can't manage properly. And so we will bring that legislation change. We also want the ombudsman to be able to initiate their own investigations. At the moment, they only investigate based on complaints. And we need to change that as well. And I'd ask the legislature to see if we can actually expedite that and bring those changes as quickly as possible. Dignity and well-being. That's the third prong of our approach going forward, where we continue within the first 1,000 days of a child's life. And here, specifically, I want to talk about, and I'm talking to parents now, I first want to say thank you very much. During the hard lockdown, we saw a massive dip in vaccinations of our young children. But between the parents of our province and the health department, it's really nice to see that we've caught up those vaccinations that we were so far behind. Thank you very much, and well done to the teams while fighting this pandemic, in enabling us to actually create this catch-up space. So I want to thank you for that. And of course, those immunizations talk to us also about the other vaccines that are going to be coming in a major way. And we need to make sure all of these are working together. We need to make sure that we set up our children from day one in those first 1,000 days, because those set the path for those children to play a much more prominent and important role in their futures and in our own future as a country and region. I also want to say that the impact of COVID-19 has been massive on specifically so many of our children going hungry. We're seeing it in stunting. And there I want to say that at the moment we've always measured stunting in our hospitals. I really want to thank our team who are now re-looking at how we bring in data, how we get to understand before it's too late. Because already when you stunted and you malnutrition, or you've got malnutrition, or you've even passed on because of malnutrition and you get into our health system, it is too late. It is way too late. We need to make sure that we get there ahead of time. So I want to thank the data team with health on how we actually are now creating an opportunity that we can actually measure it earlier on. And it is critical that we do that. This is also a part where I want to say to Minister Schaefer, thank you very much when we were really pushed at a national level, even locally, to say stop feeding our children. You pushed on, our schools pushed on, and we made sure that nutrition was out there during this very difficult time. And of course, this is a major problem for us. We cannot, I mean, I think the last thing in the world you want is to see malnourished children. So thank you very much, despite all that pressure, to have continued to do that. So I think in both of these areas, I think leading from the front, thank you very much. We really appreciate it. I said 4 months ago that early childhood development was something that we were going to focus on very differently as a province. You know that an ECD space, that's a rocket booster for a child. That enables a child to really find a better life ahead of them if we create that environment. It is also an amazing opportunity for mom because it allows mom to go out and play a role in the economy. And so it is seen by us now as a critical service in our province. I want to say that we've had October presentation on the recovery plan, we've had a second wave, but what we have managed to do is set a date for April, where I want to call an ECD consultative forum. And so in April that will happen, where we bring in all the ECDs, where we have a real discussion, listen to what the challenges are, work out how that transition is going to take place between DSD and education, really get to understand the environment because it is such a critical service. But even in the interim, I want to say congratulations to the department, ECDs. We supported 3,801 ECDs in the last few months to open safely. 95% of all registered ECDs managed to open. We gave them PPE and all sorts of support. Also, I want to thank Minister Fernandes for her ethical leadership during the hard lockdowns on continuing to make sure that we supported ECDs during this time as well. Also, where other provinces weren't doing it, they were locking everything down. And in this province, we were leading from the front and making sure that we were supporting this critical sector in our system. I also want to say primary and secondary school education, we've really, really worked hard at making sure that it's a safe environment in this last year. In actual fact, the statistics show that you were much safer being at school than not being at school. I also want to thank the department and minister for the rollout of PPE and sanitizer at a cost-effective way, not making sure that we are ripping off the taxpayer. I also think that we've definitely, just like in health, been world-class and led from the and thank you very much for that. It has been an incredibly difficult year for learners, an incredibly difficult year for teachers, and also an incredibly difficult year for parents. And it's not going to change in the next few months. But thank you very much, and we look forward to this year in learning and getting better and better as we move forward. I also want to congratulate you for once again in the TIMS results, best by far, maths and science in South Africa. Well done, and keep that up. We've got to, despite all these pressures, we've got to keep the excellence going. And I'm also looking forward to the continued rollout of STEM to STEAMAC. Of course, you know that that is something that is in the STEAMAC space, something that is I'm really passionate about. I think it is how we create that new future and those new opportunities for our youth in our region to be globally competitive. So I'm looking forward to that. I also want to say that our priority to ensure that learning continues during the COVID-19 pandemic. I spoke about that, but at the same time, that we also faced, I think, two major blows. The first was how we had to keep learners in school, and I mean, that really put a lot of pressure on us, a lot of pressure on our teachers. I mean, many of our teachers were not able to teach. They had comorbidities. We had huge risks in the system. But despite all that, we saw innovation, we saw investment, we saw extra help coming in. We also have another blow, which is the equitable share and the infrastructure money that's coming into the system. And that is being cut drastically. And so just as we've got such a core competency of this provincial government being health, Another core competency is our education space. And we are put under immense pressure. But what we have to do is also use these pressures to find ways to innovate, to find ways, as we have shown in this last year, that we can actually do things differently. We can make sure that we lead from the front. I also want to say that I spoke about those extra assistant teachers, 1,953 extra assistant teachers last year coming into the system. I also want to congratulate you on your commit to finish. I personally, Tracy and I, our daughter was completing matric last year. We could see the difficult year that it was. So many of our matrics, you know, trying to sort of face this final year of their schooling career, all of the great things that are supposed to go with your matric were not there. And of course, your ability to get quality learning time was always under pressure so that you could get the best marks that you cared, which was the next step in your future. And I think your commit to finish was really a great program. Thank you. And then perhaps lastly on this side is I want to talk about broadband. And we've been rolling out broadband for quite a while now. We're now on 1,297 of our schools, of our 1,523 schools, are connected to broadband. This very school is connected to broadband, one of those schools, 100 megabits per second. But, and it's not only the school, I think by the end of the month, it will be the library or the museum, there will be a couple of other connections, 100 megabits per second here in Genadendal. But by next year, October, that's going to move to 1 gig. That really does change Genadendal. That really does change our ability to educate. And there again, congratulations on your system where you're partnering school classes. I believe you've now moved, I think it's 58 schools now in 8 districts where classrooms can partner because they're on the back of this Wi-Fi system. This year ahead, we're also going to be redeveloping and designing as well as building 6 new schools despite the budget pressures. And of course, I think I must also mention another 2 collaboration schools coming into our system where we partner again. We believe in partnerships. And then lastly, education, I also must make mention of Apex High School in Easter River. I think you've got to celebrate those that really step up and make a massive difference. And I want to thank the principal, the teachers of that school, a no-fee school, and lockdown, hard lockdown level 5 came. That night they held an emergency meeting and they said, our students cannot suffer because of this. And they got to work. They brought in an app. This app is called Moodle. I haven't really got to interact with it properly, but I have downloaded it. And it's an app that anybody can download. And you can actually create an education system that you can enable your students to work freely from home. And they did that during the lockdown so that they did not miss 1 day of school. And they were recognized and they won the first prize in the News 24 awards for outcomes in schools. And I think that's really an amazing achievement. And we really congratulate the whole team at Apex High in Easter River. Well done. I also want to again say that Minister Shea, thank you very much. And my last point again is the amount of meals that we've managed to give over and above our normal feeding system. The number of meals that we've given to children during this time has been really going above and beyond. And I really want to thank you very much for that. Then, Speaker, I want to move on to the last point on education, which is the evaluation. I spoke about how we're pushing boundaries in federalism, how we actually using our constitutional mandate even more. And Ms. Karen Bidell, she and I met each other for the first time when I joined you to congratulate them in the establishment of this authority, this evaluation authority. And of course, if you don't measure, you can't manage. We need to be evaluating our schools. And despite lots of pressure, you still stood up and said, we are going to do this, and we got it through. And I think here we would also show leading from the front. And we must actually see, I'm not sure whether they're ready to roll it out in other parts of the country, but This is how we improve. We learn from each other. So congratulations, already 54 evaluations done while we were in COVID-19. And of course, these will enable us to have better and better results. Then of course, still going forward, housing opportunities. I also want to say to Minister Simmers, thank you very much. I think your innovative ways of innovative thinking in human settlements is really nice to see, where we're also looking at innovative ways of moving away from bricks and mortar to much more innovative building mechanisms, better managing heat and cold, faster to build, more cost effective. I also want to congratulate you on your housing app, how we actually make more data available, linking housing lists with citizens' ability to go and check on their phones. And even if you don't have a phone, if you're here in Genadendal and you've got a free link at your local library, you can go and use our broadband system and you can go and check via that on the computer there, on your app, where you are on the housing system. It's much more open and transparent, which is exactly like we want to be. You can go to one of our Cape access points, access centres, and update your housing app. I also want to say to you that this process of updating our database, it has been a huge conundrum wherever you go. When you go into communities, this morning talking to citizens here in Genadendal, asking where they are on the housing list, what's happening on that system, this is going to enable people to be able to be up to date all the time. I also want to congratulate you on your rent to buy program, which is going to be landed in this region. Burgemeester, baie geluk, dit gaan in Kapagallis wees, 10 million rand wat hy gee for this new system where it is rent to buy. And we know so many of our citizens are burdened through being blacklisted and not able to find or have access to credit. Through this system, they're going to be able to build value, their own wealth through this system. They're going to be able to put a roof over their heads, and through renting to buy, they will eventually end up with ownership, and we will find a system to actually get them out of being blacklisted. At the same time, I also want to congratulate you on your voucher systems and your rollout of your voucher systems, and as well as your revolving fund. Your revolving fund, which is going to make money available to local authorities specifically on how we get that base infrastructure in place into pieces of land as quickly as possible so that we can get the land transfer happening. I also want to say that we've purchased another 130 hectares of prime land in CBDs. This is going to give another 13,000 housing opportunities, as well as the Department of Public Works, who have handed over the power of attorney over a number of well-placed pieces of land in CBDs so that we can also roll out more housing in our town centres and in our city centres. Minister Bridell will also be tabling in Cabinet in the next couple of weeks our inclusionary housing policy, and of course as soon as that's tabled we'll be able to put that out so that we can have some public comment on it. I want to have last two points that I want to make on land, on housing. I want to again reiterate the opportunities missed at Helen Bowden. This is a crucial development for housing in the inner city of the city of Cape Town. Actually right at one of the most prime pieces of real estate on the African continent. And this piece of property has been hijacked, has been illegally occupied, has been taken, the opportunities have been taken away from other law-abiding citizens. This is absolutely unacceptable. And we have to now go through long, costly, tedious processes to evict people so that we can continue with our plans to build proper, dignified opportunity for housing in inner cities. Quite frankly, the organizations and the individuals who continue to illegally occupy spaces is absolutely unacceptable. And as I said, we will use the courts. We will continue for those areas that have been illegally occupied, land illegally occupied. It's immoral, it's illegal, it's corrupt, and we will continue with our process through the courts to end this so that we can actually get on with our work and make sure we make key differences for citizens in prime spaces of our province. And then just about in closing, members, you'll be happy to know that after education and human settlements, I must just end off again on health. You spoke a lot about health and the role that they played in COVID, but health too, as a department, We will continue to make sure that we give healthcare, world-class healthcare, to the citizens of our province. Dignity that comes through healthcare. First of all, we will talk about, you know, how we make sure we play catch-up. I spoke about the vaccines, but there's so many other people who have not got to our hospital systems, our healthcare systems, because of stages of cancer. Perhaps they were on stage one, but because it was lockdown or they're nervous of COVID-19, they didn't go to our health systems. Please, you've got to make sure that you use that health system, because when you get to our health system in stage four, it is much more difficult for us to treat you, much more difficult for us to help you. Please make sure of this amazing health system that we've got, our 400 primary healthcare facilities, our 50 hospitals, our 250 ambulances, our 13,000 nurses, and our 3,800 community healthcare workers are there to help you, the citizen, be able to have dignity, be able to live a healthy, happy life. But please make sure you utilize these services. I also want to say that in infrastructure, I think we learned a lot in building infrastructure. We built the Hospital of Hope in the CTICC in 6 short weeks. We need to continue using these innovations in how we build our normal infrastructure. And that meeting with Dr. Ramakgopa yesterday spoke also about infrastructure. Minister Madikizela, thank you very much with your team and the health team. We will be opening the Helderberg Hospital Emergency Center this year. We will be building a new clinic in Gansbaai. We will be building a new clinic in Laingsburg. We will be the honorable member from Laingsburg. Thank you very much for that. We will be building a new emergency center at the Victoria Hospital. And of course, we almost finished building the new Forensic Pathology Institute in Observatory next to the Groote Schuur Hospital. We also must continue to innovate, Speaker. We must continue as a government to utilize this opportunity where we have less resources, just as we did in dealing with COVID-19. We need to make sure that we become a more agile government. We need to make sure that we are more citizen-focused, that everything we do is making a difference for those nearly 7 million people who live in this province. We need to make sure that we become a leaner government. We need to make sure that we lead from the front with how we govern. We've got governance right. We've got those basics right. They must become habits in our system. And now with those as habits, we've now got to make sure that we innovate, we redesign, and we actually become that leading from the front, cutting-edge government. I also want to mention, almost in closing, how in part of that innovation, I want to just talk a bit about the war room and the results of the war room. I had the opportunity just over a month and a half ago, 2 months ago, to have a report back from the war room. And of course, it's been really difficult in a war room system where we want to make sure that we roll out problem-driven iterative adaptation, which needs you in the teams to be able to go on site in that government department or go on site in that business to understand, not from management, but from seeing yourself what those problems are and how you take that mechanism and that tool to change things. And of course, even during this difficult time of COVID-19, we saw the role that they played in making sure we got that backlog of 25,000 deeds in the deeds office sorted out. We saw that blockages with our heritage organization, we saw how those blockages changed and how developers could have appointments and get messages on WhatsApp at what time their appointment would happen instead of waiting for 3 days for their appointment to come about. We saw that in the property development and investment capital investment work group, we saw how those changes were made and we saw the enthusiasm that was coming from the industry. And now is the time to take these to the next level. Of course, it was difficult, but I must say what really stood out for me was when those presentations were done, and hopefully the presentation can be done to the standing committee, where we had officials from an entity Minister Marais from Heritage, one of your officials from Heritage reporting alongside an official from the city of Cape Town, alongside one of our provincial department officials, doing a presentation on what had happened and how this team had got to these solutions. That stood out for me as how government departments had broken down those barriers in the interest of finding innovative new ways of fixing things. I will also commit to continue being a government of innovation, We heard from an interjection, we need to speak to people. From the day one in this government, First Thursdays, and even during lockdown, we continued with First Thursdays. We just put them onto radios across our province, enabling people through social media, through our radio systems, to ask us any question you like. We continued with that open, transparent way through our digicons of communicating week after week with the citizens of this province, answering questions from journalists, open questions, and also at the same time receiving questions in through social media platforms. We will continue to make sure that we serve the people of this province, the people of the Western Cape, with care and integrity. We will continue to make sure that we manage through our extended cabinets, bringing in municipalities and districts, bringing in municipal managers and heads of department regularly to talk about the problems faced by the citizens of this province. We co-design and we co-manage and we co-create and innovate in ways to find solutions where there are problems facing the citizens of this province. So in conclusion, Mr. Speaker, I want to say, first of all, thank you very much, number one, for again bringing us here to Genadendal. It's been amazing being here, and I look forward to touring and being here for the debate tomorrow. I look forward to that debate, members. I look forward to you as members in this House, not only just criticizing or pulling apart some of the stuff that we do, is your job, is oversight, but also bringing us ideas, bringing new innovative ideas. This is a gathering of elected representatives of the whole province. All political parties gathered together. This is where we must bring all of those ideas together, and I promise you that we will bring those ideas into our system. Speaker, I want to also take this opportunity to once again say thank you very much to every single one of those citizens who've navigated along with us the difficult path of the last year. I want to say to the DG and the team here in the province, thank you very much. To those healthcare workers, those teachers, those police officers and law enforcement officers that were the front line, thank you very much. I want to thank the cabinet, our team. Thank you very much for the way in which we have managed, for the way in which we, in each and every one of your portfolios, has led from the front and stood out. I really do appreciate it. I want to thank this parliament, to the members of this parliament. I mean, we really were amazing how very quickly we got up and running online, how we kept the oversight going. Thank you very much for that role, the connection to the constituents. I want to thank every single citizen for the opportunity to have been here in Genadendal, but to deliver a state of the province here from Genadendal to the rest of the citizens in this province. I thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Premier, members, guests. I see.
Point of order, Speaker.
Point of order, Honorable Dagmar, what's your point of order?
Yeah. Thank you very much, Speaker. The point of order concerns the fact that the Premier indicated to us that a speech would be made available, which we have now received, and then he proceeded to do his presentation. Now, we have to respond tomorrow, as has been indicated, but in his speech, Speaker, the Premier made a statement which doesn't appear in his written speech, which I just want to ask if we can have clarity, because it's a critical point. The Premier said that the South Africa is 40 million vaccines short. Now, I just want to know that given the number that are being provided by COVAX, by Pfizer, which is more, whether, no, I would like to ask whether that is what the Premier actually said, that South Africa is 40 million vaccines short. That's what I would like to know so we can respond.
Thank you, Honorable Dagmar. I had to allow the Honourable Member to state the point of order that he's raising, but today's session, in terms of the standing rules, it's only for the
one item on the order paper, and that is the state of the province address. But let me take the point of order from the Chief Whip, please.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker. I'd like to point to the rule of anticipation. Appearing on the order paper of tomorrow is the debate on what the Premier shared with us today. So if the Honourable Member would use his ample time tomorrow to bring up these points. Thank you.
Thank you, Honourable Chief Whip. Honourable, the Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you very much. I'm aware that there's, on the, just to respond to the Speaker, I'm aware that there's only one item on the agenda, but we, as the Premier himself said,
have to respond to the speech tomorrow. So if the Premier, in his written speech, says nothing about 40 million, all we want to clarify so that we can respond, because we don't have...
Thank you.
We would just want to know,
thank
did
you,
he say,
members.
And does he maintain that South
That's
Africa
fine.
Is 40 million vaccine
thank you,
short?
Honorable
Otherwise,
Dagmo.
We can't respond.
Honourable Dagmo, thank you. The point has been made, and the... In terms of Rule 14 of our standing rules, it is clear what we're doing today, as I indicated. So tomorrow there is an opportunity to debate. And fortunately, the Premier will also have an opportunity to respond to the Honourable Members. So use the opportunity tomorrow to hit hard if you want to, as the Premier indicated, and make sure that you get the hard-pressing questions that need to be responded to. May I then at this stage, Honourable Members, and of course, thank the Honourable Premier for delivering his State of the Province address, but to thank you, Honourable Members, for your participation in this State of the Province address, your attendance, for your support, and to thank the esteemed guests for your presence here, and of course, our fourth estate, the members of the media, thank you, and thank to the school. We know we are here again tomorrow. So the leadership of the school, we are forever indebted to you. So we are back here tomorrow, the 18th of February, and we'll be here at 9:30 a.m. We are starting at that time with our proceedings. Let me invite all of you to a luncheon. And obviously, immediately after lunch, we'll have an opportunity to tour this beautiful town of Genadendal. And let us please enjoy. We'll be led by the chairperson of the museum, Genadendal Museum, Reverend Edson. And for that, we are forever grateful. At this stage, Honourable Members, please rise for the procession and remain standing until the procession is concluded. The session is adjourned. I thank you. Thank you.